afternoon and good evening to all of you. Welcome to the ALNAP meetings. Today's session is about older people and people with disabilities challenging dominant narratives in humanitarianism, hosted by Arbiter Samariter Bun, ASP Indonesia and the Philippines, and Disability Inclusive Disaster Risk Reduction Network, DIDRN. Okay, before we run the session, I have a message from ALNAP. The ALNAP meeting is looking at learning emerging from disruption. We know that disruption creates fertile ground for learning as an organization and individual adapt their approaches to the changes that are happening around them. We also know that experience suggests change in the humanitarian system. Particularly, transformational change may have more to do with the influence of external forces than planned internship. In this discussion, we will be considering the area of disability and other age inclusion in humanitarian, and the extent to which significant disruptions such as the pandemic and disaster have given rise to the new learning over the last 18 months. So we will also be discussing the extent to which this may be indicative of sustained change within the sector or not. And the session is one of the locally led leadership during disruption series during this meeting. If you are interested in this theme, please do check the agenda for other session within the series. Now, I would like to say hello of you. We are from DIDRN, which is a consortium of like related organization of people with disabilities, disability focused development and mainstream relief organization. Yes, there are 7 organizations actually working under this consortium, and today there are 3 members will share the experience. We have ASB in here, CDD, Center for Disability in Development, and also CBM. Actually, this meeting aims to provide you with the space to rethink and change how you view and engage with people with disabilities and other people in humanitarian response. So we will do by this, presenting you the summary of our research and on barrier to disability and other age inclusion in humanitarian response. So we'll do soon, yes. And sharing a tool called 5 Inclusion Masks, which help you to recognize the different aspects related to inclusion. And also in the breakout, we will give you the opportunity to learn from 5 in case studies on how people with disability and other people use disruptions to make change in humanitarian response and get some ideas on how to improve inclusion in your response project. I think now I have a time to my colleague Lily will present the research information and key findings from Inclusive Wash Research. Lily, are you ready? And over to you.
Thank you, Rani. I hope you can hear me clearly because it's raining cats and dogs here right now. But today, I will share some of our key findings from the Investing in Inclusive Wash, which is a 20-month research project funded by ERAS Humanitarian Innovation Fund that we have just recently completed. You're probably aware that there are guidance and standards on delivering inclusive WASH, such as SPHERE and its companion standard, which is the Humanitarian Inclusion Standards for Older People and People with Disabilities. Yet, inclusive practices in humanitarian response is still very limited in most sectors, including in WASH. So this is something that we investigate in the research. What are the barriers and opportunities of enabling inclusive work in humanitarian response? Now, to answer this question, we turn into these two main categories of informants: the watch actors and older people and people with disabilities in Central Sulawesi, Indonesia, who were affected by the earthquake, tsunami, and liquefaction that happened in 2018. We did two types of data collection of watch actors. First, using online survey, where 26 watch actors who implemented a watch project in Central Sulawesi participated. And then there were 9 selected informants selected under the purposive sampling participated in our semi-structured interviews. Together with the Organization of People with Disabilities in Central Sulawesi, whom we partner with, we also interviewed 59 people with disabilities and older people affected by the disaster. Kusna and Arta in Breakout A will share their experience co-researching in humanitarian response. So if you're interested to find out more, be sure to join this breakout. So let me see. Okay, through the interview, we learned that when talking about inclusive watch, watch actors tend to give examples on tangible items or hardware items only, such as toilets or water points that are physically accessible. Only one of the watch actors interviewed talk about if other important principles to inclusion alongside physical accessibility, such as meaningful participation and empowerment of older people and people with disabilities. Ensuring meaningful participation requires capacity building for older people and people with disabilities, but no such activities were reported by the WASP actors that we interviewed. And although WASP actors reported activities to encourage community participation, there were no measures to promote direct participation of older people and people with disabilities in WASP coordination mechanisms. So what do this mean in terms of barrier to inclusion in humanitarian response? First, it means that inclusion was narrowly understood as only about physical accessibility. This narrow view forms a barrier for more inclusive work. And second, the limited opportunities for older people and people with disabilities to participate means there's also limited opportunities for WASP actors to build their knowledge, experience, skills on inclusion. And as a result, disability and older age inclusion in WASP continue to be perceived as something that's very technical, something that's very difficult. It's a status quo for inclusive humanitarian action when actors continue to see older people and people with disabilities as those who need rescues, but without capacity to contribute on making humanitarian response more inclusive. In our case studies, which we will share in the 5 breakouts, we will show you the examples of how older people and people with disabilities across different countries, such as Bangladesh, Burkina Faso, Rwanda, Niger, Indonesia, Haiti, are actively using disaster as disruptions in their lives as the opportunity to challenge this dominant narrative in humanitarianism. But first, we'll introduce a simple tool called 5 Inclusion Masks, which will show you that inclusion is not just about physical accessibility. Agnes, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Lily. Hi, everyone. This is Agnes. So to some extent, I'm sure every one of you have been practicing an inclusive approach with different tools, maybe in a disaster risk reduction and humanitarian response you or your organization did or do or are doing right now. Here, I'd like you to think and reflect on your work and think about aspects that should be in the inclusion approach. There must be many aspects, but here I'll show you 5 aspects that ensure inclusion, which is shown in Slido. You can see now that there are 5 aspects, and you are going to put these aspects in order, which you think you should go first, and later from 1 to 5. or in which order should these five steps go? Like, because you know that you have these aspects in inclusion, which one you're gonna prioritize? And now in the screen, you can see that the number one priority chosen by participants is identification. And then the second is accessibility. And then actually accessibility and meaningful participation have the same scores. And then after that, the rights and empowerment. This is interesting that every one of us have our own answer, which one we think the priority to realize the inclusion in our humanitarian work. We have been working with organization of persons with disabilities for years. And in 2016, through a feasibility study and this review of global and national regulation, policies, framework, guidelines, and lesson learned regarding disaster reductions and humanitarian action and social inclusion, we came up with the essential aspects that we later call five inclusion must in disaster risk reduction and humanitarian response. Now on the screen, you can see the five inclusion must in disaster risk reduction and humanitarian action. Let's take a look at the aspect one by one. One is identification. It is essential to conduct a proper identification in our humanitarian works and also, of course, disaster risk reduction work that is disaggregated by gender, age, and disability. It will help us to understand what kind of difficulties and barriers someone has and to understand the needs and capacity of our target group or our right holders. And then, two is accessibility. It refers not to only physical accessibility with a universal design principle, which will make sure that all people with their barriers are able to access any buildings and rooms or facilities. But it also covers non-physical accessibility such as accessible information, accessible media, and delivery, like training media and how to deliver the training or how to deliver the workshop. And what we can see now, one of the example of non-physical accessibility is to provide the language interpretation and also sign language interpretation. Accessibility also promotes reasonable accommodation whenever it is needed. Okay, the three is meaningful participation. Meaningful participation means all people can contribute, provide inputs and thoughts, express their needs and concerns, and be part of the decision-making, the decision-making mechanism. It means participation is not merely an attribution, but having a chance to participate, for instance, in developing and executing plan, monitoring and evaluation, and making decisions. Four is empowerment. Empowerment aims at building the capacity of persons with disabilities. But remember not to focus on their vulnerability, but to their capacities. If the mindset is built on vulnerability, we will lose the opportunity to see what persons with disability is capable of. Then, after we have this right mindset, we can go further to create champions and pools of facilitators. And in this session, we will see, we will be together having a chance to see our organization of persons with disability members who become facilitators. Okay, five is rights. No one left is behind, as inclusion is the right of everyone. To do so, it's essential to raise awareness and urge for all humanitarian actors' commitment to fulfillment, protection, and promotion of inclusion through multi-sectoral coordination and collaboration. Now, maybe you're wondering if the order that I made from 1 to 5 is showing which one is the most priority. In fact, the 5 inclusion masks are intentionally arranged in a wheel-like shape, like you can see on the screen right now, as no aspect are more important than others. And they are all interconnected. You cannot ensure full participation of persons with disability without proper identification and providing accessibilities to enable them be participating meaningfully. Participation of persons with disability can only be meaningful if they have capacities or empowered. Hence, the identification is a must to ensure that all people are participated or represented, and they all have the same chance to get the capacity building, be empowered, and be participated. Though this tool was developed from the perspective of a disability inclusive in disaster risk reduction and humanitarian actions, this has proven through our work that to increase inclusion of all people, we can use this same approach, including it will benefit to other groups, at-risk groups such as older people, children, minority group, etc. In the five breakouts later, we will be talking a lot about the meaningful participation of persons with disabilities and also older people, which can only be actually entirely instigated by applying other inclusion masks. To get us there, my colleague, Rani, will lead us to the breakout. So now, Rani, over to you.
Agnes, for your short and meaningful presentations today. And okay, now it's time for us to have a deeper discussion, and we will run 5 breakout rooms to give you more idea on the active participation of other people and people with disabilities in humanitarian response. Okay, in the breakout A, we have participation of people with disabilities in WASH research, an experience from Indonesia. And in the breakout B, we have a participation of people with disabilities in risk assessment in Central Sulawesi, Indonesia. And in the breakout C, there are participation of other people in Rohingya response, lesson learned from Bangladesh. And in the breakout D, there is the participation of persons with disability during the COVID-19 response. This is the lesson learned from Burkina Faso, Niger, and Rwanda. And the last, in the breakout E, there is a participation of people with disability in WASH response, an experience from Haiti.
Okay, welcome again to the main room. I hope you got more insight from the breakout room sessions. And because since we cannot be in all the same breakout in the same time, so it will be great if we can learn about what has been discussed in each breakout. So I think now it's time to me to ask each breakout representative to share the discussion summary. Yeah? Okay, and I can start from Husna. Hello, Husna. Okay, Husna, can you just in 3 minutes share your summary of discussion from breakout A?
Sure, thank you, Rani. I think it might be shorter than 3 minutes because there's only like a very few participants in my breakout room, and it was hard to create like an interactive discussion with everyone there. So yeah, we were basically just like sharing the experience of our co-researchers with disabilities, and especially about how it is important to always support the needs of co-researchers with disabilities. And in this case, Arta has also shared her experience in participating in three crucial steps in research production, which is in planning and capacity building, and then in the implementation of the research, especially in data collection, as well as in the monitoring, evaluation, and learning. Arta basically has shared that it is crucial to provide capacity building to help co-researchers with disabilities to understand and learn how to use the research instruments, and then to also enable them to influence the research directions, as well as to have a bigger decision-making power during the research productions. And in this case, Arta has explained her experience and on how that she and other co-researchers with disabilities were trying to always provide feedback and even like criticism to the research team, so that we can make sure that our research goes to the right directions. But perhaps let's just hear directly from Arta. Perhaps you can explain, like, just give a short explanation about what your experience was like at that moment, and what message do you have to the humanitarian actors out there who seek to like involve persons with disabilities in a humanitarian research? Just a quick one.
Aku ingin menyampaikan bahwa awalnya aku sama sekali belum paham segala sesuatu, belum kenal dengan ASP, belum kenal dengan ya penelitian. Tetapi makin kesini, diajak diikut serta untuk partisipasi, diajak penelitian, diajak membaca berbagai macam materi, diberitahu tentang berbagai hal, dan difasilitasi dengan aksesibilitas, saya mencoba berproses, semua itu bisa merubah saya menjadi lebih baik dan pengalamanku bertambah. Itu pesan yang ingin sampaikan.
Ya, terima kasih. Over to you, Rani. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Husna, and from Group A. And now it's time for Pak Abed. Are you there, Pak Abed? Yes, Pak Abed will share the result from Group B. And because Pak Abed will share in Indonesia.
Dalam pengaruh utamaan inklusif dalam respon kemanusiaan, ada beberapa hal yang harus kita ketahui bersama. Makna dari penyandang disabilitas dalam respon kemanusiaan. Yang kedua, memastikan semua masuk penyandang disabilitas teridentifikasi dan terdata. Yang ketiga, memastikan dan ketersediaan kebutuhan kelompok berisiko termasuk penyandang disabilitas berdasarkan kebutuhan spesifik.
Oke. Thank you, Pak Abed, for your
penilaian kebutuhan dan kapasitas kelompok berisiko di setiap respon. Yang terakhir itu, step lain yang sering kami gunakan yaitu semua terlibat, semua selamat, no one left behind.
No one left behind. Okay, thank you, Pak Abed. No one left behind. I agree in that. Yeah. Okay. Now, we can move to the breakout C. We have a Shagar in here to give the summarize from the group C. Shagar, sure. It's your turn.
Yeah. Thank you, Ronnie. So we mainly discussed about our program, the Rohingya Response Program, that was mainly focused on health and rehabilitation services for people with disabilities and older people in the camp and the host community. As you all know that there was a big influx from Myanmar back in September 2017 here in Bangladesh. Around 1 million people is living in the camp in Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh. And in a recent study, it shows that it's 12% of individuals with disabilities of total population. So this is a quite a big chunk of number of people living out there. So we started our services, like we both CDD and CBM jointly started our services back in November 2017. And we adopted our services and approach based on the feedback of older people and people with disabilities. For example, we started with our static services, like we provided our health and rehabilitation services through a static center. But we got to see that there were not too many people, for example, those who are moderate to severe types of disabilities, but they're not coming to us. So then we adopted a service called home-based rehabilitation services, where our team, they reach out to the client's shelter and provide the services. So that's one. And then second is like we also receive feedback from our beneficiaries, particularly from these women with disabilities. They were saying that they were kind of hesitant to receive therapeutic services from male therapists. On the time that we had to ensure that the female therapist should be there in the team. So that way we adopted our services based on the feedback. And we also saw that like we just only few organizations were only focusing on services for people with disabilities. Then we adopted this component called disability mainstream services, where we focused on building capacity of the other human organization staff. So for example, like there were different sectors, for example, WASH, right? So they build the toilets and all others, but those are not accessible. But we cannot build this accessible toilet and WASH facilities because we are not focusing on that. So our purpose was that building capacity of those staff of human organization so that whenever they can build, they can think about this accessibility. And we were mainly focusing on this sensitization among our mainstream immigrant colleagues as well, because different individuals have a different perspective on disability. And that also hampered not having this inclusive services in the camp and host community. So that we discussed in our presentation and the follow-up question. And we also adopted our services considering the COVID as well. For example, we had to provide our tele-rehab and tele-counseling through over mobile phones during the peak time in the COVID. And we also adopted different health measures that had to ensure when we provided our services. Yep, that's pretty much it. I stop here. And if you guys have any questions, you can have a answer. Thank you.
Okay, well done, Shagar, for your summary of discussion from Group C. Now, next, I have Oliver in here. Now, it's you know, your opportunity to share your summary from Group D.
Oh, thank you, Rani. So very short summary. I mean, we're also a small group and it was mostly my presentation. What I think is very interesting about the case study that we presented from Burkina Faso, Rwanda, and Niger was that we looked into OPDs, Organizations of Persons with Disabilities, as direct implementers. So looking at the topic of this workshop and especially about changing the narratives, I mean, what we wanted to show is that, you know, persons with disabilities are not only the passive victims in a crisis that only can receive support, but they can really be those people that thrive providing the support. And this is what we have shown with these three case studies from the COVID-19 response, how OPDs get specifically involved in organizing cash transfer and ensuring that the cash transfer is provided in a very accessible way. But we've also shown the challenges that come along with OPD involvement in humanitarian action, especially that OPDs, of course, tend to select person's disabilities as beneficiaries, which might not be in accordance to humanitarian principles. So this is a bit what we shared on the one side, really the wins and the achievements that we have made in having OPDs as direct implementers, and on the other side also the challenges that might come along with it. And what I think was also very interesting to reflect that, of course, OPDs, especially when they work at the national level, they see their role normally as in the area of advocacy, but we've also seen that through the direct implementation of humanitarian aid, this has been kind of an additional trigger that helped them to be more successful in their advocacy, because they should show to their governments, look, guys, we are already doing something very concrete in the COVID-19 response for persons with disabilities. Now it's your turn to do also something. That's it from our side.
Okay, thank you, Oliver. And last but not least, we still have Axel. Axel, can you please summarize your discussion from Group E?
If you can unmute Jennifer, because she was voluntold to do so.
Thank you. Yeah, it was a very inclusive and participatory process, that one, Axel. Thank you. So we talked about how we're often so busy with the challenge of trying to fulfill all the standards and requirements and policies and to get on and implement quickly, effectively, and be a good humanitarian worker. But then we don't spend enough time really listening properly to what people are saying. We often assume what their needs are and what their wants are from the start without being more open-minded. So we talked about the importance of asking people to tell us what is important to you and starting with that more open question rather than asking more specific questions about what are your wash needs, what are your shelter needs, but really opening that up from the beginning, especially thinking about who might be missing from that discussion, such as people with disabilities, and making sure they're included and have that space. And finally, we discussed the importance of local associations that already exist in a place, including those that work with people with multiple different types of disability, and speaking with them, partnering with them, and really listening to them instead of putting other structures into place on top of them and displacing their work. So it was just a very small group, so that's a short summary.
Wow, thank you, Jennifer. Okay, thank you everyone for sharing your breakout discussion. It's very great. And now we closer to the conclusion. We hope that from our session today, you have learned some important points. I have some points in here. The first, that inclusion is not just about the accessibility. There are also important aspects such as identification for people with disabilities, accessibility, rights, meaningful participation, and empowerment. And second, you can use the 5 inclusion maps as your guide in developing inclusive humanitarian programming. And the third, remember that the people with disabilities and older people have the rights and willingness and also capacities to actively participate in humanitarian response. They are not a passive recipient of aid. In contrast, they have turned the disruptions in their lives into opportunities to make transformative of revolutionary change in humanitarian response. So please join us in this inclusive revolution. Okay, now before I end up the session, I'd like you to know that if you want to connect further with our speakers, for instance, if you still have some questions or you would like to learn more, please join in the networking session. We have an additional 15 minutes to continue the conversation. There will be Lily, Husna, Axel, Oliver, Shagar, and Fabio in the networking room. That's all from me. Thank you. Have a good day.